my goal always is to question, make the audience question who they should be rooting for. Who is the protagonist? I don't believe in, there are very few purely evil or purely good people in my screenplays, because I've met very few purely evil or purely good people. It's interesting to watch someone do something evil, become evil, and question why that is, and watch someone who's not very good do something that's really selfless. I think it's a really interesting way to, you know, examine the human experience. And so my goal was to not tell you why they're doing what they're doing, because why they're doing it, albeit wrong, is noble in its genesis. And if you know it from the beginning, then you will root for them.
Oh, these boys, they aren't done yet, I'll tell you that.
How come?
Oh, well, they're patient. They're just sticking to the drawers, not taking the hundreds. That's the bank's money. We can trace that. They're trying to raise a certain amount, that's my guess. It's going to take a few banks to get there.
I grew up in a small town in Texas, and all those towns were so vibrant. And the people who remained, you know, they're really, really tough people. And so I decided I wanted to tell a story about them. At the same time, my cousin, who'd been a federal marshal in Texas, and his brother were forced into retirement. Kind of arbitrarily, there's this number that that you reach, and, you know, the day before he was forced to turn in his gun and his badge, he was kicking down a door, arresting some guy with a warrant, and still very physically able to do the job. But because of a number, he was mandated to retire. And the combination of things seemed to me really fascinating to explore, and so I explored them together.
You got any idea how much I owe Debbie in child support?
Got enough in your front pocket to fix that problem right now.
You can't spare it, you know that.
Maybe we should hit another branch.
Toby and Tanner represent a cycle of poverty and the consequence of domestic violence and how success and failure can be handed down generation to generation. And, you know, from Toby's standpoint, the movie's about, you know, ending that cycle. And he fully expects to sacrifice himself in doing so. His brother, who had already sacrificed himself to protect Toby, and has basically been living in martyrdom of its own kind for, you know, two decades.
You know, they loaned the least they could, just enough to keep your mama poor on a guaranteed return. Thought they could swipe her land for $25,000. That's just so arrogant it makes my teeth hurt. To see you boys pay those bastards back with their own money? Well, if that ain't Texan, I don't know what is.
I don't judge. I can't, you know, because then it's not impartial. I'm gonna not write the scene where something bad happens in one bank, because I'm not gonna wanna make that hero look more human. I'm gonna wanna purely paint the bank as the villain. And banks aren't necessarily villainous, they're corporations. It's people within them trying to mitigate, you know, greed and corporate quarterly profits, and do we serve a service, and all these other things. So it wasn't an F you to the banks at all. It was one individual at one bank in particular that did a rather insidious thing to one person, and the only way that he could get his land back was to, you know, do what he did.
This is what they call white man's intuition.
Sometimes a blind pig finds a truffle.
A real stark realism to the way that he, you know, he tells a story, and then an elegance to it, and a sort of a certain energy in the camera that made him really right. David's view of this was a very clear, unprejudiced look at the world and at the story. He told the story. He captured it in the way that I imagined it, and that's a real testament to his skill.